in the Subantarctic, we have rockhopper penguins, elephant seals, grey-headed albatrosses, all declining quite markedly. So for example, for the rockhopper penguin, between the 1940s and the 1980s, which was when the last complete census was undertaken, the population of rockhopper penguins on Campbell declined from over 1 million birds to something a little over 100,000 birds. So that's a decline of over 90% in a few decades, which is quite dramatic. Normally when populations go down, for albatrosses, for example, the finger's usually pointed at the fishing industry. It's an interaction between the seabirds and the fishing industry, and they're attracted to the boats, of course, because it's a supply of food. And seabirds and fishing boats generally don't mix particularly well. The outcomes usually increase mortality for the seabirds. But in the case of the three species I just mentioned, the grey-headed albatross, that's not caught in New Zealand fisheries at all. There's very little evidence that it interacts in a bad way around New Zealand. Southern elephant seals don't interact with the fishing industry either, as far as we can tell, so that's not the reason for their decline. And likewise, rockhopper penguins don't interact with the fishing industry. There's never been a fatality of rockhopper penguins in the New Zealand sector from the fishing industry, as far as we know. So we have three species of top-level predator, all declining, and the obvious smoking gun doesn't exist. Speculation is centred around changes in the marine system itself. It might be something to do with the changes in sea temperature or the amount of food that's in the system for these animals to feed on, or some other more complex mixture of a whole range of factors that we really only got to scratch the surface as our understanding of what's going on down there. But there's clearly a complex, widespread, at-sea reason for why these animals are declining. We focused our attention on rockhopper penguins. They're obviously quite a small penguin. They nest colonially in large groups, so they're relatively easy to work on. And previous work had shown that there was some suggestion that the sea temperature in the subantarctic, around Campbell Island in particular, was increasing. So whilst the penguin population was declining, the sea temperature was actually going up. And there was some suggestion of a period of a few years when the sea temperature started to go down again and the penguin number started to recover slightly. So we had a little bit of something to go on, and beyond that there wasn't really much of an idea of what was causing the penguins to decline. Clearly the temperature itself is not the reason. The penguins can withstand a wide range of temperatures. When they're on land in the sun it's quite warm, when they're in the sea it's quite cold. So temperature itself isn't the reason. This change in sea temperature might be having a follow-on effect on their food supply, for example. So that's the angle that we took. We tried to investigate whether there was a change over that long time period of the amount of food or the type of food in the marine system that these penguins were feeding on, whether that was a reason for their population to decline. So that might be acting in a way, for example, that there was less food in the system. If there's less food, there's clearly going to be less penguins. Or that there's the same amount of food, the diet was the same, they hadn't changed their diet, but the food was becoming less available for some reason that we didn't really understand. And of course, it's hard to retrospectively go back in time and work out what penguins were feeding on in the 1940s or prior to that. But fortunately for penguins and for seabirds in general, people tended to kill these animals for specimens, which then ended up in museum collections as study skins. So these are essentially the skin of the animal, of the bird. All the feathers are still intact, and they get put away in museum collections for people to come along and work on for years to come. And they're a fantastic resource. And in the case of penguins, a particularly valuable resource for this question, because what we were able to do was go back in time, effectively, sample feathers from study skins of rockhopper penguins collected by numerous people and stored in museum collections all around the world. So off we trotted to Paris and New York and Washington and wherever else that penguins were kept. And we sampled a small numbers of feathers. So we had a feather sample from a particular moment in time in the past. And then what we did was take those feather samples and determine the ratio of stable isotopes of common elements, carbon and nitrogen. And the important thing about these two ratios of these isotopes is that it provides you a large amount of information about what's going on in the marine system. So in the case of carbon, it tells you how productive the marine system was when that feather was grown by the penguin. So here we have a means of looking back in time to say how productive was the marine system around Campbell Island when a penguin was alive in 1940, or indeed in 1900. And we had samples going all the way back to about 1860, I think. And we collected samples from all around the world, museum collections all around the world, from penguins that have been breeding at a range of sites, not just in New Zealand. And then we collected contemporary feathers from penguins breeding both in New Zealand and overseas. And we ran the analysis. And what we found was that generally, penguins' diet hadn't changed over time. So we couldn't say that penguins in the 1940s were feeding on a particular sort of food and now they're not, they're feeding on a different sort of food and that's the reason for the decline. That wasn't the case, the diet had stayed the same. What we did find was that the carbon signature, the carbon 13 to 12 ratio, which is that proxy for ocean productivity, had declined at several sites over time. And one of the areas where that was the case was in the New Zealand sector. So rockhopper penguins breeding in Campbell Island, and they also breed at the Antipodes Islands as well in New Zealand. From about 1900, where our samples began, all the way through to the present day, which was about the year 2000, we saw this decline in carbon 13 signature, which corresponded to a decline in the ocean productivity in which they were feeding. So we think that the reason why the penguins were declining, and it may well be the reason why southern elephant seals also declined, and also grey-headed albatrosses, these are animals that feed in the same part of the ocean. They tend to feed to the south of New Zealand, they don't tend to come to the north. The reason could be that the productivity of the system has declined over time. Of course, that begs the question, why has the productivity of the system declined over time? And that's where we're at this stage. We don't really understand why the system has declined to the extent that it has in terms of productivity. It may be some human-induced process, climate change, that's driving that along, or it may just be some very long-term cyclical oscillation in the system, and in time productivity might bounce back and these upper-level predators might also recover.